The Dialogue of St. Catherine of Siena, Part 15, A Treatise of Prayer. Of the means which the soul takes to arrive at pure and generous love. And here begins the Treatise of Prayer. When the soul has passed through the doctrine of Christ crucified, with true love of virtue and hatred of vice, and has arrived at the house of self-knowledge and entered therein, she remains, with her door barred, in watching and constant prayer, separated entirely from the consolations of the world. Why does she thus shut herself in? She does so from fear, knowing her own imperfections, and also from the desire which she has of arriving at pure and generous love. And because she sees and knows well that in no other way can she arrive thereat, she waits, with a lively faith, for my arrival, through increase of grace in her. How is a lively faith to be recognized? By perseverance in virtue, and by the fact that the soul never turns back for anything, whatever it be, nor rises from holy prayer for any reason, except, note well, for obedience or charity's sake. For no other reason ought she to leave off prayer, for during the time ordained for prayer, the devil is wont to arrive in the soul, causing much more conflict and trouble than when the soul is not occupied in prayer. This he does in order that holy prayer may become tedious to the soul, tempting her often with these words, "This prayer avails you nothing, for you need attend to nothing except your vocal prayers." He acts thus in order that, becoming wearied and confused in mind, she may abandon the exercise of prayer, which is a weapon with which the soul can defend herself from every adversary, if grasped with the hand of love, by the arm of free choice, in the light of the holy faith. Here, touching something concerning the sacrament of the body of Christ, the complete doctrine is given, and how the soul proceeds from vocal to mental prayer, and a vision is related which this devout soul once received. Know, dearest daughter, how by humble, continual, and faithful prayer the soul acquires, with time and perseverance, every virtue. Wherefore should she persevere and never abandon prayer, either through the illusion of the devil or her own fragility, that is to say, either on account of any thought or movement coming from her own body, or of the words of any creature. The devil often places himself upon the tongues of creatures, causing them to chatter nonsensically, with the purpose of preventing the prayer of the soul. All of this she should pass by means of the virtue of perseverance. Oh, how sweet and pleasant to that soul, and to me, is holy prayer, made in the house of knowledge of self and of me, opening the eye of the intellect to the light of faith, and the affections to the abundance of my charity, which was made visible to you through my visible only begotten Son, who showed it to you with his blood, which blood inebriates the soul, and clothes her with the fire of divine charity, giving her the food of the sacrament, which is placed in the tavern of the mystical body of the Holy Church, that is to say, the food of the body and blood of my Son, holy God and holy man, administered to you by the hand of my vicar, who holds the key of the blood. This is that tavern which I mentioned to you, standing on the bridge, to provide food and comfort for the travelers and the pilgrims who pass by the way of the doctrine of my truth, lest they should faint through weakness. This food strengthens little or much, according to the desire of the recipient, whether he receives sacramentally or virtually. He receives sacramentally when he actually communicates with the Blessed Sacrament. He receives virtually when he communicates, both by desire of communion and by contemplation of the blood of Christ crucified, communicating, as it were, sacramentally, with the affection of love, which is to be tasted in the blood, which, as the soul sees, was shed through love. On seeing this, the soul becomes inebriated and blazes with holy desire and satisfies herself, becoming full of love for me and for her neighbor. Where can this be acquired? In the house of self-knowledge with holy prayer, where imperfections are lost, even as Peter and the disciples, while they remained in watching and prayer, lost their imperfection and acquired perfection. By what means is this acquired? By perseverance seasoned with the most holy faith. But do not think that the soul receives such ardor and nourishment from prayer if she pray only vocally, as do many souls whose prayers are rather words than love. Such as these give heed to nothing except to completing psalms and saying many paternosters. And when they have once completed their appointed tale, they do not appear to think of anything further, but seem to place devout attention and love in merely vocal recitation, which the soul is not required to do. For in doing only this, she bears but little fruit, which pleases me but little. But if you ask me whether the soul should abandon vocal prayer, since it does not seem at all that they are called to mental prayer, I should reply, no. The soul should advance by degrees. And I know well that just as the soul is at first imperfect and afterwards perfect, so also is it with her prayer. She should nevertheless continue in vocal prayer while she is yet imperfect, so as not to fall into idleness. But she should not say her vocal prayers without joining them to mental prayer. That is to say, that while she is reciting, she should endeavor to elevate her mind in my love, with the consideration of her own defects and of the blood of my only begotten Son, wherein she finds the breath of my charity and the remission of her sins. And this she should do so that self-knowledge and the consideration of her own defects should make her recognize my goodness in herself and continue her exercises with true humility. I do not wish defects to be considered in particular, but in general, so that the mind may not be contaminated by the remembrance of particular and hideous sins. But as I said, I do not wish the soul to consider her sins, either in general or in particular, without also remembering the blood and the broadness of my mercy, for fear that otherwise she should be brought to confusion. And together with confusion would come the devil, who has caused it, under color of contrition and displeasure of sin. And so she would arrive at eternal damnation, not only on account of her confusion, but also through the despair which would come to her, because she did not seize the arm of my mercy. This is one of the subtle devices with which the devil deludes my servants, and in order to escape from his deceit and to be pleasing to me, you must enlarge your hearts and affections in my boundless mercy, with true humility. You know that the pride of the devil cannot resist the humble mind, nor can any confusion of spirit be greater than the broadness of my good mercy, if the soul will only truly hope therein. Wherefore it was, if you remember rightly, that once, when the devil wished to overthrow you by confusion, wishing to prove to you that your life had been deluded, and that you had not followed my will, you did that which was your duty, which my goodness, which is never withheld from him who will receive it, gave you strength to do. That is, you rose, humbly trusting in my mercy, and said, I confess to my Creator that my life has indeed been passed in darkness, but I will hide myself in the wounds of Christ crucified, and bathe myself in his blood, and so shall my iniquities be consumed, and with desire will I rejoice in my Creator. You remember that then the devil fled, and turning round to the opposite side, he endeavored to inflate you with pride, saying, You are perfect and pleasing to God, and there is no more need for you to afflict yourself or to lament your sins. and once more I gave you the light to see your true path, namely, humiliation of yourself. And you answered the devil with these words, 'Wretch that I am, John the Baptist never sinned and was sanctified in his mother's womb, and I have committed so many sins, and have hardly begun to know them with grief and true contrition, seeing who God is, who is offended by me, and who I am, who offend him.' Then the devil, not being able to resist your humble hope in my goodness, said to you, 'Cursed that you are, for I can find no way to take you. If I put you down through confusion, you rise to heaven on the wings of mercy. And if I raise you on high, you humble yourself down to hell. And when I go into hell, you persecute me, so that I will return to you no more, because you strike me with the stick of charity.' The soul, therefore, should season the knowledge of herself with the knowledge of my goodness, and then vocal prayer will be of use to the soul who makes it, and pleasing to me, and she will arrive, from vocal imperfect prayer, exercised with perseverance, at perfect mental prayer. But if she simply aims at completing her tale, and for vocal abandons mental prayer, she will never arrive at it. Sometimes the soul will be so ignorant that, having resolved to say so many prayers vocally, and I, visiting her mind sometimes in one way and sometimes in another, in a flash of self-knowledge or of contrition for sin, sometimes in the broadness of my charity, and sometimes by placing before her mind in diverse ways, according to my pleasure and the desire of the soul, the presence of my truth. She, the soul, in order to complete her tale, will abandon my visitation, that she feels, as it were, by conscience, rather than abandon that which she had begun. She should not do so, for in so doing she yields to a deception of the devil. The moment she feels her mind disposed by my visitation in the many ways I have told you, she should abandon vocal prayer. Then, my visitation passed, if there be time, she can resume the vocal prayers which she had resolved to say. But if she has not time to complete them, she ought not on that account to be troubled or suffer annoyance and confusion of mind, of course, provided that it were not the divine office which clerics and religious are bound and obliged to say under penalty of offending me, for they must, until death, say their office. But if they, at the hour appointed for saying it, should feel their minds drawn and raised by desire, they should so arrange as to say it before or after my visitation, so that the debt of rendering the office be not omitted. But in any other case, vocal prayer should be immediately abandoned for the said cause. Vocal prayer, made in the way that I have told you, will enable the soul to arrive at perfection, and therefore she should not abandon it, but use it in the way that I have told you. And so, with exercise and perseverance, she will taste prayer in truth, and the food of the blood of my only begotten Son. And therefore I told you that some communicated virtually with the body and blood of Christ, although not sacramentally. That is, they communicate in the affection of charity, which they taste by means of holy prayer, little or much, according to the affection with which they pray. They who proceed with little prudence and without method taste little, and they who proceed with much taste much. For the more the soul tries to loosen her affection from herself and fasten it in me with the light of the intellect, the more she knows. And the more she knows, the more she loves. And loving much, she tastes much. You see, then, that perfect prayer is not attained to through many words, but through affection of desire, the soul raising herself to me, with knowledge of herself and of my mercy, seasoned the one with the other. Thus she will exercise together mental and vocal prayer. For even as the active and contemplative life is one, so are they. Although vocal or mental prayer can be understood in many and diverse ways, For I have told you that a holy desire is a continual prayer, in this sense, that a good and holy will disposes itself with desire to the occasion actually appointed for prayer, in addition to the continual prayer of holy desire. Wherefore, vocal prayer will be made at the appointed time by the soul who remains firm in a habitual holy will, and will sometimes be continued beyond the appointed time, according as charity commands, for the salvation of the neighbor, if the soul see him to be in need, and also her own necessities according to the state in which I have placed her. Each one, according to his condition, ought to exert himself for the salvation of souls, for this exercise lies at the root of a holy will, and whatever he may contribute, by words or deeds, toward the salvation of his neighbor, is virtually a prayer, although it does not replace a prayer which one should make oneself at the appointed season. As my glorious standard-bearer Paul said, in the words, "He who ceases not to work, ceases not to pray." It was for this reason that I told you that prayer was made in many ways, that is, that actual prayer may be united with mental prayer if made with the affection of charity, which charity is itself continual prayer. I have now told you how mental prayer is reached by exercise and perseverance, and by leaving vocal prayer for mental when I visit the soul. I have also spoken to you of common prayer, that is, of vocal prayer in general, made outside of ordained times, and of the prayers of goodwill, and how every exercise, whether performed in oneself or in one's neighbor, with goodwill, is prayer. The enclosed soul should therefore spur herself on with prayer, and when she has arrived at friendly and filial love, she does so. Unless the soul keep to this path, she will always remain tepid and imperfect, and will only love me and her neighbor in proportion to the pleasure which she finds in my service. Reader's note. In Catherine's time, respect for the sacrament of Holy Communion was so great that frequent communication was discouraged, except by priests actually celebrating Mass. Non-priests were lucky to receive communion once a year at Easter. The spiritual communion referred to is the act of fervently wishing to receive communion when one is otherwise unable. This is still a good practice today in situations such as when one is sick at home or too far from a Catholic church to go to Mass on Sunday. The Dialogue of St. Catherine of Siena, Part 16. Of the method by which the soul separates herself from imperfect love, and attains to perfect love, friendly and filial. Hitherto I have shown you in many ways how the soul raises herself from imperfection and attains to perfection, which she does after she has attained to friendly and filial love. I tell you that she arrives at perfect love by means of perseverance, barring herself into the house of self-knowledge, which knowledge of self requires to be seasoned with knowledge of me, lest it bring the soul to confusion, for it would cause the soul to hate her own sensitive pleasure and the delight of her own consolations. But from this hatred, founded in humility, she will draw patience, with which she will become strong against the attacks of the devil, against the persecutions of man, and toward me, when, for her good, I withdraw delight from her mind. And if her sensuality, through malevolence, should lift its head against reason, the judgment of conscience should rise against it, and with hatred of it, hold out reason against it, not allowing such evil emotions to get by it. Though sometimes the soul who lives in holy hatred corrects and reproves herself, not only for those things that are against reason, but also for things that in reality come from me, which is what my sweet servant St. Gregory meant when he said that a holy and pure conscience made sin where there was no sin, that is, through purity of conscience, It saw sin where there was no sin. Now, the soul who wishes to rise above imperfection should await my providence in the house of self-knowledge, with the light of faith, as did the disciples, who remained in the house in perseverance and in watching, and in humble and continual prayer, awaiting the coming of the Holy Spirit. She should remain fasting and watching, the eye of her intellect fastened on the doctrine of my truth, and she will become humble because she will know herself in humble and continual prayer and holy and true desire. Of the signs by which the soul knows she has arrived at perfect love. It now remains to be told you how it can be seen that souls have arrived at perfect love. This is seen by the same sign that was given to the holy disciples after they had received the Holy Spirit, when they came forth from the house and fearlessly announced the doctrine of my word, my only begotten Son, not fearing pain, but rather glorying therein. They did not mind going before the tyrants of the world to announce to them the truth, for the glory and praise of my name. So the soul, who has awaited me in self-knowledge as I have told you, receives me on my return to her with the fire of charity, in which charity, while still remaining in the house with perseverance, she conceives the virtues by affection of love, participating in my power, with which power and virtues she overrules and conquers her own sensitive passions, and through which charity she participates in the wisdom of my Son, in which she sees and knows, with the eye of her intellect, my truth and the deceptions of spiritual self-love, that is, the imperfect love of her own consolations, as has been said. And she knows also the malice and deceit of the devil, which he practices on those souls who are bound by that imperfect love. She therefore arises with hatred of that imperfection, and with love of perfection, and through this charity, which is of the Holy Spirit, she participates in his will, fortifying her own to be willing to suffer pain, and, coming out of the house through my name, she brings forth the virtues on her neighbor. Not that by coming out to bring forth the virtues, I mean that she issues out of the house of self-knowledge, but that in the time of the neighbor's necessity, she loses that fear of being deprived of her own consolations, and so issues forth to give birth to those virtues which she has conceived through affection of love. The souls who have thus come forth have reached the fourth state, that is, from the third state, which is a perfect state, in which they chase charity and give birth to it on their neighbors, they have arrived at the fourth state, which is one of perfect union with me. The two last-mentioned states are the united. That is to say, one cannot be without the other, for there cannot be love of me without love of neighbor, nor love of the neighbor without love of me. How they who are imperfect desire to follow the Father alone, but they who are perfect desire to follow the Son. And of a vision which this holy soul had, concerning diverse baptisms, and of many other beautiful and useful things. As I have told you, these latter have issued forth from the house, which is a sign that they have arisen from imperfection and arrived at perfection. Open the eye of your intellect, and see them running by the bridge of the doctrine of Christ crucified, which was their way, rule, way, and doctrine. They place none other before the eye of their intellect than Christ crucified. Not the Father, as they do who are in imperfect love, and do not wish to suffer pain, but only to have the delight which they find in me. But they, as if drunken with love and burning with it, have gathered together and ascended the three steps, which I figured to you as the three powers of the soul, and also the three actual steps, figured to you as in the body of my only Son, Christ crucified, by which steps the soul, as I told you, ascended, first climbing to the feet, with the feet of the soul's affection, from thence arriving at the side, where she found the secret of the heart, and knew the baptism of water, which has virtue through the blood, and where I disposed the soul to receive grace, uniting and kneading her together in the blood. Where did the soul know of this her dignity, in being kneaded and united with the blood of the Lamb, receiving the grace in holy baptism in virtue of the blood? In the side, where she knew the fire of divine charity. And so, if you remember well, my truth manifested to you, when you asked, "Sweet and immaculate Lamb, you were dead when your side was opened. Why then did you want to be struck and have your heart divided?" And he replied to you, telling you that there was occasion enough for it. But the principal part of what he said, I will tell you. He said, "Because my desire toward the human generation was ended, and I had finished the actual work of bearing pain and torment, and yet I had not been able to show by finite things, because my love was infinite, how much more love I had, I wished you to see the secret of the heart, showing it to you open, that you might see how much more I loved than I could show you by finite pain. I poured from it blood and water to show you the baptism of water, which is received in virtue of the blood. I also showed the baptism of love in two ways. First, in those who are baptized in their blood, shed for me, which has virtue through my blood, even if they have not been able to have holy baptism. And also in those who are baptized in fire, not being able to have holy baptism, but desiring it with the affection of love. There is no baptism of fire without the blood, because the blood is steeped in and kneaded with the fire of divine charity, because through love was it shed. There is yet another way by which the soul receives the baptism of blood, speaking, as it were, under a figure, and this way the divine charity provided, knowing the infirmity and fragility of man, through which he offends, not that he is obliged, through his fragility and infirmity, to commit sin unless he wished to do so, but falling as he will into the guilt of mortal sin, by which he loses the grace which he drew from holy baptism in virtue of the blood, it was necessary to leave a continual baptism of blood. This the divine charity provided in the sacrament of holy confession, the soul receiving the baptism of blood with contrition of heart, confessing when able to my ministers who hold the keys of the blood, sprinkling it in absolution upon the face of the soul. But if the soul be unable to confess, contrition of heart is sufficient for this baptism, the hand of my clemency giving you the fruit of this precious blood. But if you are able to confess, I wish you to do so. And if you are able to, and do not, you will be deprived of the fruit of the blood. It is true that in the last extremity, a man desiring to confess and not being able to, will receive the fruit of this baptism of which I have been speaking. But let no one be so mad as to arrange his deeds that in the hope of receiving it, he puts off confessing until the last extremity of death, when he may not be able to do so. In which case, it is not at all certain that I shall not say to him, in my divine justice, "You did not remember me in the time of your life when you could. Now will I not remember you in your death." You see, then, that these baptisms, which you should all receive until the last moment, are continual. And though my works, that is, the pains of the cross, were finite, the fruit of them you receive in baptism through me is infinite. This is in virtue of the infinite divine nature, united with the finite human nature, which human nature endures pain, in me, the Word, clothed with your humanity. but because the one nature is steeped in and united with the other, the eternal deity drew to himself the pain which I suffered with so much fire and love. And therefore can this operation be called infinite? Not that my pain, neither the actuality of my body, be infinite, nor the pain of the desire that I had to complete your redemption, because it was terminated and finished on the cross when the soul was separated from the body, but the fruit which came out of the pain and desire for your salvation is infinite, and therefore you receive it infinitely. Had it not been infinite, the whole human generation could not have been restored to grace, neither the past, the present, nor the future. This I manifested in the opening of my side, where is found the secret of the heart, showing that I loved more than I could show with finite pain. I showed to you that my love was infinite. How? By the baptism of blood, united with the fire of my charity, and by the general baptism given to Christians and to whomever will receive it, and by the baptism of water, united with the blood and the fire, wherein the soul is steeped. And in order to show this, it was necessary for the blood to come out of my side. Now I have shown you, said my truth to you, what you asked of me. The Dialogue of St. Catherine of Siena, Part 17. How worldly people render glory and praise to God, whether they will or no. And so perfect is her vision that she sees the glory and praise of my name, not so much in the angelic nature as in the human, for whether worldly people will or no, they render glory and praise to my name. Not that they do so in the way they should, loving me above everything, but that my mercy shines in them, in that, in the abundance of my charity, I give them time, and do not order the earth to open and swallow them up on account of their sins. I even wait for them, and command the earth to give them of her fruits, the sun to give them light and warmth, and the sky to move above them. And in all things created and made for them, I use my charity and mercy, withdrawing neither on account of their sins. I even give equally to the sinner and the righteous man, and often more to the sinner than to the righteous man, because the righteous man is able to endure privation, and I take from him the goods of the world, that he may the more abundantly enjoy the goods of heaven. So that in worldly men my mercy and charity shine, and they render praise and glory to my name, even when they persecute my servants. For they prove in them the virtues of patience and charity, causing them to suffer humbly and offer to me their persecutions and injuries, thus turning them into my praise and glory. So that, whether they will or no, worldly people render to my name praise and glory, even when they intend to do me infamy and wrong. How even the devils render glory and praise to God. Sinners, such as those of whom I have just spoken, are placed in this life in order to augment virtues in my servants, as the devils are in hell as my justiciars and augmenters of my glory, that is, my instruments of justice toward the damned, and the augmenters of my glory in my creatures, who are wayfarers and pilgrims on their journey to reach me, their end. They augment in them the virtues in diverse ways, exercising them with many temptations and vexations, causing them to injure one another and take one another's property, and not for the motive of making them receive injury or be deprived of their property, but only to deprive them of charity. But in thinking to deprive my servants, they fortify them, proving in them the virtues of patience, fortitude, and perseverance. Thus they render praise and glory to my name, and my truth is fulfilled in them, which truth created them for the praise and glory of me, Eternal Father, and that they might participate in my beauty. But rebelling against me in their pride, they fell and lost their vision of me, Wherefore they rendered not to me glory through the affection of love, and I, eternal truth, have placed them as instruments to exercise my servants in virtue in this life, and as justiciars to those who go, for their sins, to the pains of purgatory. Thus you see that my truth is fulfilled in them, that is, that they render me glory, not as citizens of life eternal, of which they are deprived by their sins, but as my justiciars, manifesting justice upon the damned and upon those in purgatory. How the soul, after she has passed through this life, sees fully the praise and glory of my name in everything, and though in her the pain of desire is ended, the desire is not. Thus in all things created, in all rational creatures, and in the devils, is seen the glory and praise of my name. Who can see it? The soul who is denuded of the body and has reached me, her end, sees it clearly, and in seeing, knows the truth. Seeing me, the eternal Father, she loves, and loving, she is satisfied. Satisfied, she knows the truth, and her will is stayed in my will, bound and made stable, so that in nothing can it suffer pain, because it has that which it desired to have before the soul saw me, namely, the glory and praise of my name. She now, in truth, sees it completely in my saints, in the blessed spirits, and in all creatures and things, even in the devils, as I told you. And although she also sees the injury done to me, which before caused her sorrow, it no longer now can give her pain, but only compassion, because she loves without pain, and prays to me continually with affection of love, that I will have mercy on the world. Pain in her is ended, but not love, as the tortured desire which my word the Son had borne from the beginning when I sent him into the world, terminated on the cross in his painful death, but his love, no. For had the affection of my charity, which I showed you by means of him, been terminated and ended then, you would not be, because by love you are made. And had my love been drawn back, that is, had I not loved your being, you could not be, but my love created you, and my love possesses you, because I am one thing with my truth, and he, the Word incarnate, with me. You see, then, that the saints and every soul in eternal life have desire for the salvation of souls without pain, because pain ended in their death, but not so the affection of love. Thus, as if drunk with the blood of the Immaculate Lamb, and clothed in the love of the neighbor, they pass through the narrow gate, bathed in the blood of Christ crucified, and they find themselves in me, the sea Pacific, raised from imperfection, far from satiety, and arrived at perfection, satisfied by every good. How after St. Paul was drawn to the glory of the blessed, he desired to be loosened from the body, as they do who have reached the aforesaid third and fourth states. Paul, then, had seen and tasted this good when I drew him up into the third heaven, that is, into the height of the Trinity, where he tasted and knew my truth, receiving fully the Holy Spirit, and learning the doctrine of my truth, the Word incarnate. The soul of Paul was clothed through feeling and union in me, the Eternal Father, like the Blessed Ones in eternal life, except that his soul was not separated from his body except through this feeling and union. But it being pleasing to my goodness to make of him a vessel of election in the abyss of me, the Eternal Trinity, I dispossessed him of myself, because on me can no pain fall, and I wished him to suffer for my name. Therefore I placed before him, as an object for the eyes of his intellect, Christ crucified, clothing him with the garment of his doctrine, binding and fettering him with the clemency of the Holy Spirit, and inflaming him with the fire of charity. He became a vessel, disposed and reformed by my goodness, and on being struck, made no resistance, but said, "My Lord, what do you wish me to do? Show me that which it is your pleasure for me to do, and I will do it." which I answered when I placed before him Christ crucified, clothing him with the doctrine of my charity. I illuminated him perfectly with the light of true contrition, by which he extirpated his defects and founded him in my charity. How the soul who finds herself in the unitive state desires infinitely to have the barren earthly state and unite herself, to leave the barren earthly state and unite herself to God. And when I depart from the soul in the aforesaid way, that the body may return a little to its corporal sentiment, the soul, on account of the union which she had made with me, is impatient in her life, being deprived of union with me, and the conversation of the immortals, who render glory to me, and finding herself amid the conversation of mortals, and seeing them so miserably offending me. This vision of my offense is the torture which such souls always have, and which, with the desire to see me, renders their life insupportable to them. Nevertheless, as their will is not their own, but becomes one with mine, they cannot desire other than what I desire, and though they desire to come and be with me, they are contented to remain, if I desire them to remain, with their pain, for the greater praise and glory of my name, and the salvation of souls, so that in nothing are they in discord with my will, but they run their course with ecstatic desire, clothed in Christ crucified, and keeping by the bridge of his doctrine, glorying in his shame and pains. Inasmuch as they appear to be suffering, they are rejoicing, because the enduring of many tribulations is to them a relief in the desire which they have for death. For oftentimes the desire and the will to suffer pain mitigates the pain caused them by their desire to quit the body. These not only endure with patience, as I told you they did who are in the third state, but they glory through my name in bearing much tribulation. In bearing tribulation they find pleasure, and not having it they suffer pain, fearing that I reward not their well-doing, or that the sacrifice of their desires is not pleasing to me. But when I permit to them many tribulations, they rejoice, seeing themselves clothed with the suffering and shame of Christ crucified. Wherefore, were it possible for them to have virtue without toil, they would not want it. They would rather delight in the cross, with Christ, acquiring it with pain, than in any other way obtain eternal life. Why? Because they are inflamed and steeped in the blood, where they find the blaze of my charity, which charity is a fire proceeding from me, ravishing their heart and mind, and making their sacrifices acceptable. Wherefore, the eye of the intellect is lifted up and gazes into my deity, when the affection behind the intellect is nourished and united with me. This is a sight which I grant to the soul infused with grace, who in truth loves and serves me. How they who are arrived at the aforesaid unitive state have the eye of their intellect illuminated by supernatural light infused with grace, and how it is better to go for counsel for the salvation of the soul to a humble and holy conscience rather than to a proud lettered man. With this light that is given to the eye of the intellect, Thomas Aquinas saw me, wherefore he acquired the light of much science. Also Augustine, Jerome, and the doctors, and my saints. They were illuminated by my truth to know and understand my truth in darkness. By my truth, I mean the Holy Scripture, which seemed dark because it was not understood, not through any defect of the Scriptures, but of them who heard them and did not understand them. Wherefore I sent this light to illuminate the blind and coarse understanding, uplifting the eye of the intellect to know the truth. And I, fire, acceptor of sacrifices, ravishing away from them their darkness, give the light, not a natural light, but a supernatural, so that, though in darkness, they know the truth. Wherefore that, which at first appeared to be dark, now appears with the most perfect light, to the gross or subtle mind. And everyone receives according as he is capable or disposed to know me, for I do not despise dispositions. So you see that the eye of the intellect has received supernatural light, infused by grace, by which the doctors and saints knew light in darkness, and of darkness made light. The intellect was before the scriptures were formed. Wherefore, from the intellect came science, because in seeing they discerned. It was thus that the holy prophets and fathers understood, who prophesied of the coming and death of my Son, and the apostles, after the coming of the Holy Spirit, which gave them that supernatural light. The evangelists, doctors, professors, virgins, and martyrs were all likewise illuminated by the aforesaid perfect light. And everyone has had the illumination of this light, according as he needed it for his salvation, or that of others, or for the exposition of the Scriptures. The doctors of the holy science had it, expounding the doctrine of my truth, the preaching of the apostles, and the gospels of the evangelists. The martyrs had it, declaring in their blood the most holy faith, the fruit and the treasure of the blood of the Lamb. The virgins had it in the affection of charity and purity. To the obedient ones is declared by it the obedience of the word, showing them the perfection of obedience, which shines in my truth, who, for the obedience that I imposed upon him, ran to the opprobrious death of the cross. This light is to be seen in the Old and New Testament. In the Old, by it were seen by the eye of the intellect and known the prophecies of the holy prophets. In the New Testament of the evangelical life, how is the gospel declared to the faithful? By this same light. And because the New Testament proceeded from the same light, the new law did not break the old law. Rather, are the two laws bound together, the imperfection of the old law, founded in fear alone, being taken from it, by the coming of the word of my only begotten Son, with the law of love, completing the old law by giving it love, and replacing the fear of penalty by holy fear. And therefore, said the truth to the disciples, to show that he was not a breaker of laws, I came not to dissolve the law, but to fulfill it. It is almost as if my truth would say to them, the law is now imperfect, but with my blood I will make it perfect, and I will fill it up with what it lacks, taking away the fear of penalty, and founding it in love and holy fear. How is this declared to be the truth? By this same supernatural light, which was and is given by grace to all who will receive it. Every light that comes from Holy Scripture comes and came from this supernatural light. Ignorant and proud men of science were blind, notwithstanding this light, because their pride and the cloud of self-love had covered it up and put out the light. Wherefore they understood the Holy Scripture rather literally than with understanding, and taste only the letter of it, still desiring many other books. And they get not to the marrow of it, because they have deprived themselves of the light with which is found and expounded the Scripture. And they are annoyed and murmur, because they find much in it that appears to them gross and idiotic. And nevertheless, they appear to be much illuminated in their knowledge of Scripture, as if they had studied it for long. And this is not remarkable, because they have, of course, the natural light from whence proceeds science. But because they have lost the supernatural light, infused by grace, they neither see nor know my goodness, nor the grace of my servants. Wherefore I say to you that it is much better to go for counsel for the salvation of the soul to a holy and upright conscience, rather than to a proud lettered man, learned in much science. Because such a one can only offer what he has himself, and because of his darkness, it may appear to you that, from what he says, the Scriptures offer darkness. The contrary will you find with my servants, because they offer the light that is in them, with hunger and desire for the soul's salvation. This I have told you, my sweetest daughter, that you might know the perfection of this unitive state, when the eye of the intellect is ravished by the fire of my charity, in which charity it receives the supernatural light. With this light, the souls in the unitive state love me, because love follows the intellect, and the more it knows, the more can it love. Thus the one feeds the other, and with this light they both arrive at the eternal vision of me, where they see and taste me, in truth, the soul being separated from the body, as I told you when I spoke to you of the blissfulness that the soul received in me. This state is most excellent when the soul, being yet in the mortal body, tastes bliss with the immortals. And oftentimes she arrives at so great a union that she scarcely knows whether she be in the body or out of it, and tastes the earnest money of eternal life, both because she is united with me, and because her will is dead in Christ, by which death her union was made with me. And in no other way could she perfectly have done so. Therefore do they taste life eternal, deprived of the hell of their own will, which gives to man the earnest money of damnation, if he yield to it. The Dialogue of St. Catherine of Siena, Part 18. How this devout soul seeks knowledge from God concerning the state and fruit of tears. Then this soul, yearning with very great desire, and rising as one intoxicated both by the union which she had had with God, and by what she had heard and tasted of the supreme and sweet truth, yearned with grief over the ignorance of creatures, in that they did not know their benefactor, or the affection of the love of God. And nevertheless she had joy from the hope of the promise that the truth of God had made to her, teaching her the way she was to direct her will, and the other servants of God as well as herself, in order that he should do mercy to the world. And lifting up the eye of her intellect upon the sweet truth, to whom she remained united, wishing to know somewhat of the aforesaid states of the soul of which God had spoken to her, and seeing that the soul passes through these states with tears, she wished to learn from the truth concerning the different kinds of tears, and how they came to be, and whence they proceeded, and the fruit that resulted from weeping. Wishing then to know this from the sweet, supreme, and first truth, as to the manner of being and reason of the aforesaid tears, and inasmuch as the truth cannot be learnt from any other than from the truth himself, and nothing can be learnt in the truth but what is seen by the eye of the intellect, she made her request of the truth. For it is necessary for him who is lifted with desire to learn the truth with the light of faith. Wherefore, knowing that she had not forgotten the teaching which the truth, that is, God, had given her, that in no other way could she learn about the different states and fruits of tears, she rose out of herself, exceeding every limit of her nature with the greatness of her desire. And with the light of a lively faith, she opened the eye of her intellect upon the eternal truth, in whom she saw and knew the truth, in the matter of her request. For God himself manifested it to her, and condescending in his benignity to her burning desire, fulfilled her petition. How there are five kinds of tears. Then said the supreme and sweet truth of God, O beloved and dearest daughter, you beg knowledge of the reasons and fruits of tears, and I have not despised your desire. Open well the eye of your intellect, and I will show you, among the aforesaid states of the soul, of which I have told you, concerning the imperfect tears caused by fear, but first rather of the tears of wicked men of the world. These are the tears of damnation. The former are those of fear, and belong to men who abandon sin from fear of punishment, and weep for fear. The third are the tears of those who, having abandoned sin, are beginning to serve and taste me, and weep for very sweetness. But since their love is imperfect, so also is their weeping, as I have told you. The fourth are the tears of those who have arrived at the perfect love of their neighbor, loving me without any regard whatsoever for themselves. These weep, and their weeping is perfect. The fifth are joined to the fourth, and are tears of sweetness let fall with great peace, as I will explain to you. I will tell you also of the tears of fire, without bodily tears of the eyes, which satisfy those who often would desire to weep and cannot. And I wish you to know that all these various graces may exist in one soul, who, rising from fear and imperfect love, reaches perfect love in the unitive state. Now, I will begin to tell you of these tears in the following way. Of the difference of these tears, arising from the explanation of the aforesaid state of the soul. I wish you to know that every tear proceeds from the heart, for there is no member of the body that will satisfy the heart so much as the eye. If the heart is in pain, the eye manifests it, and if the pain be sensual, the eye drops hearty tears which engender death, because proceeding from the heart, they are caused by a disordinate love distinct from the love of me. For such love, being disordinate and an offense to me, receives the meed of mortal pain and tears. It is true that their guilt and grief are more or less heavy, according to the measure of their disordinate love. And these form that first class, who have the tears of death, of whom I have spoken to you, and will speak again. Now, begin to consider the tears which give the commencement of life, the tears, that is, of those who, knowing their guilt, set to weeping for fear of the penalty they have incurred. These are both hearty and sensual tears, because the soul, not having yet arrived at perfect hatred of its guilt on account of the offense thereby done to me, abandons it with a hearty grief for the penalty which follows the sin committed, while the eye weeps in order to satisfy the grief of the heart. But the soul, exercising herself in virtue, begins to lose her fear, knowing that fear alone is not sufficient to give her eternal life, as I have already told you when speaking of the second stage of the soul. And so she proceeds, with love, to know herself and my goodness in her, and begins to take hope in my mercy, in which her heart feels joy. Sorrow for her grief, mingled with the joy of her hope in my mercy, causes her eye to weep, which tears issue from the very fountain of her heart. But inasmuch as she has not yet arrived at great perfection, she often drops sensual tears, and if you ask me why, I reply, because the root of self-love is not sensual love, for that has already been removed, as has been said, but it is a spiritual love with which the soul desires spiritual consolations, or loves some creature spiritually. I have spoken to you at length regarding the imperfections of such souls. Wherefore, when such a soul is deprived of the things she loved, that is, eternal or external consolation, the internal being the consolation received from me, the external being that which she had from the creature, and when temptations and the persecutions of men come on her, her heart is full of grief. And as soon as the eye feels the grief and suffering of the heart, she begins to weep with a tender and compassionate sorrow, pitying herself with the spiritual compassion of self-love. For her self-will is not yet crushed and destroyed in everything, and in this way she lets fall sensual tears, tears, that is, of spiritual passion. But growing and exercising herself in the light of self-knowledge, she conceives displeasure at herself and finally perfect self-hatred. From this she draws true knowledge of my goodness with a fire of love, and she begins to unite herself to me, and to conform her will to mine, and so to feel joy and compassion. Joy in herself, through the affection of love, and compassion for her neighbor, as I told you in speaking of the third stage. Immediately her eye, wishing to satisfy the heart, cries with hearty love for me and for her neighbor, grieving solely for my offense and her neighbor's loss, and not for any penalty or loss due to herself, for she does not think of herself, but only rendering glory and praise to my name, and in an ecstasy of desire, she joyfully takes the food prepared for her on the table of the Holy Cross, thus conforming herself to the humble, patient, and immaculate Lamb, my only begotten Son, of whom I made a bridge, as I have said. Having thus sweetly traveled by that bridge, following the doctrine of my sweet truth, enduring with true and sweet patience every pain and trouble which I have permitted to be inflicted upon her for her salvation, having manfully received them all, not choosing them according to her own tastes, but accepting them according to mine, and not only, as I said, enduring them with patience, but sustaining them with joy, she counts it glory to be persecuted for my name's sake, in whatever she may have to suffer. Then the soul arrives at such delight and tranquility of mind that no tongue can tell it. Having crossed the river by means of the eternal word, that is, by the doctrine of my only begotten Son, and having fixed the eye of her intellect on me, the sweet supreme truth, having seen the truth, knows it, and knowing it, loves it. Drawing her affection after her intellect, she tastes my eternal deity, and she knows and sees the divine nature united to your humanity. Then she reposes in me, the sea Pacific, and her heart is united to me in love, as I told you when speaking of the fourth and unitive state. When she thus feels me, the eternal deity, her eyes let fall tears of sweetness, tears indeed of milk, nourishing the soul in true patience. An odoriferous ointment are these tears, shedding odors of great sweetness. Oh, best beloved daughter, how glorious is that soul who has indeed been able to pass from the stormy ocean to me, the sea Pacific, and in that sea which is myself, the supreme and eternal deity, to fill the pitcher of her heart. And her eye, the conduit of her heart, endeavors to satisfy her heart pangs, and so sheds tears. This is the last stage in which the soul is blessed and sorrowful. Blessed she is through the union which she feels herself to have with me, tasting the divine love, sorrowful through the offenses which she sees done to my goodness and greatness. For she has seen and tasted the bitterness of this in her self-knowledge, by which self-knowledge, together with her knowledge of me, she arrived at the final stage. Yet this sorrow is no impediment to the unitive state, which produces tears of great sweetness through self-knowledge, gained in love of the neighbor, in which exercise the soul discovers the plaint of my divine mercy, and grief at the offenses caused to her neighbor, weeping with those who weep, and rejoicing with those who rejoice, that is, who live in my love. Over these the soul rejoices, seeing glory and praise rendered me by my servants, so that the third kind of grief does not prevent the fourth, that is, the final grief belonging to the unitive state. They rather give savor to each other, for had not this last grief, in which the soul finds such union with me, developed from the grief belonging to the third state of neighborly love, it would not be perfect. Therefore it is necessary that the one should flavor the other, else the soul would come to a state of presumption, induced by the subtle breeze of love of her own reputation, and would fall at once, vomited from the heights to the depths. Therefore, it is necessary to bear with others, and practice continually love to one's neighbor, together with true knowledge of oneself. In this way will she feel the fire of my love in herself, because love of her neighbor is developed out of love of me, that is, out of that learning which the soul obtained by knowing herself and my goodness in her. When, therefore, she sees herself to be ineffably loved by me, She loves every rational creature with the self-same love with which she sees herself to be loved. And for this reason, the soul that knows me immediately expands to the love of her neighbor, because she sees that I love that neighbor ineffably, and so herself loves the object which she sees me to have loved still more. She further knows that she can be of no use to me, and can in no way repay me that pure love with which she feels herself to be loved by me, and therefore endeavors to repay it through the medium which I have given her, namely, her neighbor, who is the medium through which you can all serve me. For as I have said to you, you can perform all virtues by means of your neighbor, I having given you all creatures, in general and in particular, according to the diverse graces each has received from me, to be ministered unto by you. You should therefore love them with the same pure love with which I have loved you. That pure love cannot be returned directly to me, because I have loved you without being myself loved, and without any consideration of myself whatsoever, for I loved you without being loved by you, before you existed. It was indeed love that moved me to create you to my own image and similitude. This love you cannot repay to me, but you can pay it to my rational creature, loving your neighbor without being loved by him, and without consideration of your own advantage, whether spiritual or temporal, but loving him solely for the praise and glory of my name, because he has been loved by me. Thus will you fulfill the commandment of the law, to love me above everything, and your neighbor as yourselves. True indeed is it that this height cannot be reached without passing through the second stage, namely, the second stage of union, which becomes the third and final stage. Nor can it be preserved when it has been reached, if the soul abandon the affection from which it has been developed, the affection to which the second class of tears belongs. It is therefore impossible to fulfill the law given by me, the eternal God, without fulfilling that of your neighbor. For these two laws are the feet of your affection, by which the precepts and counsels are observed, which were given you, as I have told you, by my truth, Christ crucified. These two states united nourish your soul in virtue, making her to grow in the perfection of virtue and in the unitive state. Not that the other state is changed, because this further state has been reached, for this further state does but increase the riches of grace in new and various gifts and admirable elevations of the mind, in the knowledge of the truth, as I said to you, which, though it is mortal, appears immortal, because the soul's perfection of her own sensuality is mortified, and her will is dead through the union which she has attained with me. Oh, how sweet is the taste of this union to the soul, for in tasting it she sees my secrets. Wherefore she often receives the spirit of prophecy, knowing the things of the future. This is the effect of my goodness. But the humble soul should despise such things, not indeed in so far as they are given her by my love, but in so far as she desires them by reason of her appetite for consolation, considering herself unworthy of the peace and quiet in mind, in order to nourish virtue within her soul. In such a case, let her not remain in the second stage, but return to the valley of self-knowledge. I give her this light, my grace permitting, so that she may ever grow in virtue. For the soul is never so perfect in this life that she cannot attain to a higher perfection of love. My only begotten Son, your captain, was the only one who could increase in no perfection, because he was one thing with me, and I with him, wherefore his soul was blessed through union with the divine nature. But do you, his pilgrim members, be ever ready to grow in greater perfection, not indeed to another stage, for, as I have said, you have now reached the last, but to that further grade of perfection in the last stage, which may please you by means of my grace. The Dialogue of St. Catherine of Siena, Part 19. How the four stages of the soul, to which belong the five aforesaid states of tears, produce tears of infinite value, and how God wishes to be served as the infinite, and not as anything finite. These five states are like five principal canals which are filled with abundant tears of infinite value, all of which give life if they are disciplined in virtue, as I have said to you. You ask how their value can be infinite. I do not say that in this life your tears can become infinite, but I call them infinite on account of the infinite desire of your soul from which they proceed. I have already told you how tears come from the heart, and how the heart distributes them to the eye, having gathered them in its own fiery desire. As when green wood is on the fire, the moisture it contains groans on account of the heat, because the wood is green, so does the heart, made green again by the renovation of grace drawn into itself among its self-love which dries up the soul, so that fiery desire and tears are united. And inasmuch as desire is never ended, it is never satisfied in this life. But the more the soul loves, the less she seems to herself to love. Thus is holy desire, which is founded in love, exercised, and with this desire the eye weeps. But when the soul is separated from the body and has reached me, her end, she does not on that account abandon desire, so as to no longer yearn for me or love her neighbor. For love has entered into her like a woman, bearing the fruits of all other virtues. It is true that suffering is over and ended, as I have said to you, for the soul that desires me possesses me in very truth, without any fear of ever losing that which she has so long desired. But in this way, hunger is kept up, because those who are hungry are satisfied, and as soon as they are satisfied, hunger again. In this way, their satiety is without disgust, and their hunger without suffering, for in me no perfection is wanting. Thus is your desire infinite, otherwise it would be worth nothing, nor would any virtue of yours have any life if you served me with anything finite. For I, who am the infinite God, wish to be served by you with infinite service. And the only infinite thing you possess is the affection and desire of your soul. In this sense, I said that there were tears of infinite value, and this is true as regards their mode of which I have spoken, namely, of the infinite desire which is united to the tears. When the soul leaves the body, the tears remain behind. But the affection of love has drawn to itself the fruit of the tears, and consumed it, as happened in the case of the water in your furnace. The water has not really been taken out of the furnace, but the heat of the fire has consumed it and drawn it into itself. Thus the soul, having arrived at tasting the fire of my divine charity, and having passed from this life in a state of love towards me and her neighbor, having further possessed that unitive love which caused her tears to fall, does not cease to offer me her blessed desires, tearful indeed, though without pain or physical weeping, for physical tears have evaporated in the furnace, becoming tears of fire of the Holy Spirit. You see, then, how tears are infinite, how, as regards the tears shed in this life only, no tongue can tell what different sorrows may cause them. I have now told you the difference between four of these states of tears. Of the fruit of worldly men's tears. It remains for me to tell you of the fruit produced by tears shed with desire and received into the soul. But first will I speak to you of that first class of men whom I mentioned at the beginning of this my discourse, those, that is, who live miserably in the world, making a god of created things and of their own sensuality, from which comes damage to their body and soul. I said to you that every tear proceeded from the heart, and this is the truth, for the heart grieves in proportion to the love it feels. So worldly men weep when their heart feels pain, that is, when they are deprived of something which they loved. But many and diverse are their complainings. Do you know how many? There are as many as there exist different loves. And inasmuch as the root of self-love is corrupt, everything that grows from it is corrupt also. Self-love is a tree on which grow nothing but fruits of death, putrid flowers, stained leaves, branches bowed down and struck by various winds. This is the tree of the soul. For you are all trees of love, and without love you cannot live, for you have been made by me for love. The soul who lives virtuously places the root of her tree in the valley of true humility. But those who live thus miserably are planted on the mountain of pride, whence it follows that since the root of the tree is badly planted, the tree can bear no fruits of life, but only of death. Their fruits are their actions, which are all poisoned by many and diverse kinds of sins. And if they should produce some good fruit among their actions, even it will be spoiled by the foulness of its root. For no good actions done by a soul in mortal sin are of value for eternal life, for they are not done in grace. Let not, however, such a soul abandon on this account its good works, for every good deed is rewarded, and every evil deed punished. A good action performed out of a state of grace is not sufficient to merit eternal life, as has been said. But my justice, my divine goodness, grants an incomplete reward, imperfect as the action which obtains it. Often such a man is rewarded in temporal matters. Sometimes I give him more time in which to repent, as I have already said to you in another place. This also will I sometimes do. I grant him the life of grace by means of my servants, who are pleasing and acceptable to me. I acted in this way with my glorious Apostle Paul, who abandoned his infidelity and the persecutions he directed against the Christians at the prayer of Saint Stephen. See truly, therefore, that in whatever state a man may be, he should never stop doing good. I said to you that the flowers of this tree were putrid, and so in truth they are. Its flowers are the stinking thoughts of the heart, displeasing to me, and full of hatred and unkindness toward their neighbor. So if a man be a thief, he robs me of honor, and takes it himself. This flower stinks less than that of false judgment, which is of two kinds. The first with regard to me, by which men judge my secret judgments, gauging falsely all my mysteries, that is, judging that which I did in love to have been done in hatred, that which I did in truth to have been done in falsehood, that which I give them for life to have been given them for death. They condemn and judge everything according to their weak intellect, for they have blinded the eye of their intellect with sensual self-love, and hidden the pupil of the most holy faith, which they will not allow to see or know the truth. The second kind of false judgment is directed against a man's neighbor, from which often come many evils, because the wretched man wishes to set himself up as the judge of the affections and heart of other rational creatures, when he does not yet know himself. And for an action which he may see, or for a word he may hear, he will judge the affection of the heart. My servants always judge well, because they are founded on me, the supreme good. But such as these always judge badly, for they are founded on evil. Such critics as these cause hatreds, murders, unhappinesses of all kinds to their neighbors, and remove themselves far away from the love of my servant's virtue. Truly, these fruits follow the leaves, which are the words which issue from their mouth in insult to me and the blood of my only begotten Son, and in hatred to their neighbors. And they think of nothing else but cursing and condemning my works, and blaspheming and saying evil of every rational creature, according as their judgment may suggest to them. The unfortunate creatures do not remember that the tongue is made only to give honor to me, and to confess sins, and to be used in love of virtue, and for the salvation of the neighbor. These are the stained leaves of that most miserable fault, because the heart from which they proceeded was not clean, but all spotted with duplicity and misery. How much danger, apart from the spiritual privation of grace to the soul, of temporal loss may not occur. For you have all heard and seen how, through words alone, have come revolutions of states and destructions of cities, and many homicides and other evils, a word having entered the heart of the listener and having passed through a space not large enough for a knife. I say that this tree has seven branches drooping to the earth, on which grow the flowers and leaves in the way I have told you. These branches are the seven mortal sins, which are full of many and diverse wickednesses, contained in the roots and trunk of self-love and of pride, and which first made both branches and flowers of many thoughts, the leaves of words, and the fruits of wicked deeds. They stand drooping to the earth because the branches of mortal sin can turn no other way than to the earth, the fragile, disordinate substance of the world. Do not marvel, they can turn no way but that in which they can be fed by the earth, for their hunger is insatiable, and the earth is unable to satisfy them. They are insatiable and unbearable to themselves, and it is conformable to their state that they should always be unquiet, longing and desiring that thing which they have to satiety. This is the reason why such satiety cannot content them, because they, who are infinite in their being, are always desiring something finite, because their being will never end, though their life to grace ends when they commit mortal sin. Man is placed above all creatures and not beneath them, and he cannot be satisfied or content except in something greater than himself. Greater than himself there is nothing but myself, the eternal God. Therefore I alone can satisfy him, and because he is deprived of this satisfaction by his guilt, he remains in continual torment and pain. Weeping follows pain, and when he begins to weep, the wind strikes the tree of self-love, which he has made the principle of all his being. The Dialogue of St. Catherine of Siena, Part 20. How this devout soul, thanking God for his explanation of the above-mentioned states of tears, makes three petitions. Then this soul, eager with the greatness of her desire, through the sweetness of the explanation and satisfaction which she had received from the truth concerning the state of tears, said, as one enamored, "Thanks, thanks be to you, Supreme and Eternal Father, satisfier of holy desires, and lover of our salvation, who through your love gave us love himself, in the time of our warfare with you, in the person of your only begotten Son. By the abyss of your fiery love, I beg of you grace and mercy, that I may come to you truly in the light, and not flee far in darkness away from your doctrine, of which you have clearly demonstrated to me the truth, so that, by the light thereof, I perceive two other points, concerning which I fear they are, or may become, stumbling blocks to me. I beg, Eternal Father, that before I leave the subject of these states of tears, you would explain these points also to me. The first is, when a person desirous of serving you comes to me, or to some other servant of yours to ask for counsel, how should I teach him? I know, sweet and eternal God, that you answered above to this question, I am he who takes delight in few words and many deeds. Nevertheless, if it please your goodness to grant me a few more words on the subject, it will cause me the greatest pleasure. And also, if on some occasion when I am praying for your creatures, and in particular for your servants, and I seem to see the subjects of my prayer, in one I find, in the course of my prayer, a well-disposed mind, a soul rejoicing in you, and in another, as it might seem to me, a mind full of darkness, have I the right, O Eternal Father, to judge the one soul to be in light, and the other in darkness? Or, supposing I should see that the one lives in great penance, and the other does not, should I be right to judge that he who does the greater penance has the higher perfection? I pray you, so that I may not be deceived through my limited vision, that you would declare to me in detail what you have already said in general on this matter. The second request I have to make is that you will explain further to me about the sign which you said the soul received on being visited by you, the sign which revealed your presence. If I remember well, O Eternal Truth, you said that the soul remained in joy and courageous virtue. I would gladly know whether this joy can consist with the delusion of the passion of spiritual self-love. For if it were so, I would humbly confine myself to the sign of virtue. These are the things which I beg you to tell me, so that I may serve you and my neighbor in truth, and not fall into false judgment concerning your creatures and servants. For it seems to me that the habit of judging keeps the soul far from you, so I do not wish to fall into this snare. How the light of reason is necessary to every soul that wishes to serve God in truth, and first, of the light of reason in general. Then the eternal God, delighting in the thirst and hunger of that soul, and in the purity of her heart, and the desire with which she longed to serve him, turned the eye of his benignity and mercy upon her, saying, O best beloved, dearest and sweetest daughter, my spouse, rise out of yourself, and open the eye of your intellect to see me, the infinite goodness, and the ineffable love which I have towards you and my other servants. And open the ear of the desire which you feel toward me, and remember that if you do not see, you cannot hear. That is to say, that the soul who does not see into my truth with the eye of her intellect cannot hear or know my truth. Wherefore, in order that you may the better know it, rise above the feelings of your senses. And I, who take delight in your request, will satisfy your demand. Not that you can increase my delight, for I am the cause of you and of your increase, not those of mine. Yet the very pleasure that I take in the work of my own hands causes me delight. Then that soul obeyed and rose out of herself in order to learn the true solution of her difficulty. And the eternal God said to her, In order that you may the better understand what I shall say to you, I shall revert to the beginning of your request concerning the three lights which issue from me, the true light. The first is a general light dwelling in those who live in ordinary charity. I shall repeat to you here many things concerning these lights which I have already told you, in spite of my having done so, in order that your creeping intelligence may better understand that which you wish to know. The other two lights dwell in those who, having abandoned the world, desire perfection. Besides this, I will explain to you your request, telling you in great detail that which I have already pointed out to you in general. You know, as I have told you, that without the light no one can walk in the truth, that is, without the light of reason, which light of reason you draw from me, the true light, by means of the eye of your intellect and the light of faith which I have given you in holy baptism, though you may have lost it by your own defects. For in baptism, and through the mediation of the blood of my only begotten Son, you have received the form of faith, which faith you exercise in virtue by the light of reason, which gives you life and causes you to walk in the path of truth, and by its means to arrive at me, the true light, for without it you would plunge into darkness. It is necessary for you to have two lights derived from this primary light, and to these two I will also add a third. The first lightens you all to know the transitory nature of the things of the world, all of which pass like the wind. But this you cannot know thoroughly unless you first recognize your own fragility, how strong is your inclination, through the law of perversity with which your members are bound, to rebel against me, your Creator. Not that, by this law, any man can be constrained to commit any, even the smallest sin, against his will, but that this law of perversity fights lustily against the Spirit. I did not impose this law upon you in order that my rational creature should be conquered by it, but in order that he should prove and increase the virtue of his soul, because virtue cannot be proved except by its contrary. Sensuality is contrary to the Spirit, and yet, by means of sensuality, the soul is able to prove the love which she has for me, her Creator. How does she prove it? When with anger and displeasure she rises against herself. This law has also been imposed in order to preserve the soul in true humility. Wherefore you see that, while I created the soul to mine own image and similitude, placing her in such dignity and beauty, I caused her to be accompanied by the vilest of all things, imposing on her the law of perversity, imprisoning her in a body formed of the vilest substance of the earth, so that, seeing in what her true beauty consisted, she should not raise her head in pride against me. Wherefore, to one who possesses this light, the fragility of his body is a cause of humiliation to the soul, and is in no way matter for pride, but rather for true and perfect humility. So that this law does not constrain you to any sin by its strivings, but supplies a reason to make you know yourselves and the instability of the world. This should be seen by the eye of the intellect with light of the holy faith, of which I said to you that it was the pupil of the eye. This is that light which is necessary in general to every rational creature, whatever may be his condition, who wishes to participate in the life of grace, in the fruit of the blood of the Immaculate Lamb. This is the ordinary light, that is, the light which all persons must possess, as has been said, for without it the soul would be in a state of damnation. And for this reason, because the soul, being without the light, is not in a state of grace, inasmuch as, not having the light, she does not know the evil of her sin or its cause, and therefore cannot avoid or hate it. And similarly, if the soul know not good, and the reason of good, that is to say, virtue, she cannot love or desire either me, who am the essential good, or virtue, which I have given you as an instrument and means for you to receive my grace, and myself the true good. See, then, how necessary is this light, for your sins consist in nothing else than in loving that which I hate, and hating that which I love. I love virtue, and hate vice. He who loves vice and hates virtue offends me, and is deprived of my grace. Such a one walks as if blind, for he knows not the cause of vice, that is, his sensual self-love, nor does he hate himself on account of it. He is ignorant of vice and of the evil which follows it. He is ignorant of virtue and of me, who am the cause of his obtaining life-giving virtue. He is ignorant of his own dignity, which he should maintain by advancing to grace by means of virtue. See, therefore, how his ignorance is the cause of all his evil, and how you also need this light, as has been said. Of those who have placed their desire rather in the mortification of the body than in the destruction of their own will, and of the second light, more perfect than the former general one. When the soul has arrived at the attainment of the general light of which I have spoken, she should not remain contented, because as long as you are pilgrims in this life, you are capable of growth, and he who does not go forward by that very fact is turning back. She should either grow in the general light, which she has acquired through my grace, or anxiously strive to attain to the second and perfect light, leaving the imperfect and reaching the perfect. For if the soul truly have light, she will wish to arrive at perfection. In this second perfect light are to be found two kinds of perfection, for they may be called perfect who have abandoned the general way of living of the world. One perfection is that of those who give themselves wholly up to the castigation of the body, doing great and severe penance. These, in order that their sensuality may not rebel against their reason, have placed their desire rather in the mortification of the body than in the destruction of their self-will, as I have explained to you in another place. These feed their souls at the table of penance, and are good and perfect, if their penance be illuminated by discretion, and founded on me, if, that is to say, they act with true knowledge of themselves and of me, with great humility, and wholly conform to the judgment of my will, and not to that of the will of man. But if they were not thus clothed with my will in true humility, they would often offend against their own perfection, esteeming themselves the judges of those who do not walk in the same path. Do you know why this would happen to them? Because they have placed all their labor and desire in the mortification of the body rather than in the destruction of their own will. Such as these wish always to choose their own times and places and consolations after their own fashion, and also the persecutions of the world and of the devil, as I have narrated to you in speaking of the second state of perfection. They say, cheating themselves with the delusion of their own self-will, which I have already called their spiritual self-will, I wish to have that consolation, and not these battles or these temptations of the devil, not indeed for my own pleasure, but in order to please God the more, and in order to retain him the more in my soul through grace, because it seems to me that I should possess him more and serve him better in that way than in this. And this is the way the soul often falls into trouble, and becomes tedious and insupportable to herself, thus injuring her own perfection. Yet she does not perceive it, nor that within her lurks the stench of pride, and there she lies. Now, if the soul were not in this condition, but were truly humble and not presumptuous, she would be illuminated to see that I, the primary and sweet truth, grant condition, and time, and place, and consolations, and tribulations, as they may be needed for your salvation, and to complete the perfection to which I have elected the soul. And she would see that I give everything through love, and that therefore with love and reverence should she receive everything, which is what the souls in the second state do, and by doing so arrive at the third state, of whom I will now speak to you, explaining to you the nature of these two states, which stand in the most perfect light. The Dialogue of St. Catherine of Siena, Part 21. Of the third and most perfect state, and of reason, and of the works done by the soul who has arrived at this light. The Dialogue of St. Catherine of Siena, Part 22. In what way they, who stand in the above-mentioned third most perfect light, receive the earnest of eternal life in this life? Why did I say to you that they received the earnest of eternal life? I say that they receive the earnest money, but not the full payment, because they wait to receive it in me, the eternal life, where they have life without death, and satiety without disgust, and hunger without pain. For from that divine hunger, pain is far away, and though they have what they desire, disgust is far from satiety, for I am the flawless food of life. It is true that in this life they receive the earnest, and taste it in this way, namely, that the soul begins to hunger for the honor of the eternal God, and for the food of the salvation of other souls. And being hungry, she eats, that is to say, nourishes herself with love of her neighbor, which causes her hunger and desire. For the love of the neighbor is a food which never satiates him who feeds on it, the eater being insatiable and always remains hungry. So, this earnest money is a commencement of a guarantee which is given to man, in virtue of which he expects one day to receive his payment. Not through the perfection of the earnest money in itself, but through faith, through the certitude which he has of reaching the completion of his being and receiving his payment. Wherefore this enamored soul, clothed in my truth, having already received in this life the earnest of my love and of her neighbor's, is not yet perfect, but expects perfection in immortal life. I say that this earnest is not perfect, because the soul who tastes it has not, as yet, the perfection which would prevent her feeling pain in herself or in others. In herself, through the offense done to me by the law of perversity which is bound in her members and struggles against the spirit, and in others by the offense of her neighbor. She has indeed, in a sense, a perfect grace, but not that perfection of my saints, who have arrived at me, eternal life. For, as has been said, their desires are without suffering, and yours are not. These servants of mine, as I have said to you in another place, who nourish themselves at this table of holy desire, are blessed and full of grief, even as my only begotten Son was on the wood of the holy cross. Because, while his flesh was in grief and torment, his soul was blessed through its union with the divine nature. In like manner, these are blessed by the union of their holy desire toward me, clothed, as has been said, in my sweet will. And they are full of grief through compassion for their neighbor, and because they afflict their own self-love, depriving it of sensual delights and consolations. How this soul, rendering thanks to God, humiliates herself. Then she prays for the whole world, and particularly for the mystical body of the Holy Church, and for her spiritual children, and for the two fathers of her soul. And after these things, she asks to hear something about the defects of the ministers of the Holy Church. Then that soul, as if in truth inebriated, seemed beside herself, as if the feelings of the body were alienated through the union of love which she had made with her Creator. And as if, in elevation of mind, she had gazed into the eternal truth with the eye of her intellect, and having recognized the truth, had become enamored of it, and said, O supreme and eternal goodness of God, who am I, miserable one, that you, the supreme and eternal Father, have manifested to me your truth, and the hidden deceits of the devil, and the deceitfulness of personal feeling, so that I and others in this life of pilgrimage may know how to avoid being deceived by the devil or ourselves. What moved you to do it? Love, because you loved me, without my having loved you. Oh, fire of love, thanks, thanks be to you, eternal Father. I am imperfect and full of darkness, and you, perfection and light, have shown to me perfection, and the resplendent way of the doctrine of your only begotten Son. I was dead, and you have brought me to life. I was sick, and you have given me medicine, and not only the medicine of the blood which you gave for the diseased human race in the person of your Son, but also a medicine against a secret infirmity that I knew not of, in this precept that in no way can I judge any rational creature, and particularly your servants, upon whom oftentimes I, as one blind and sick with this infirmity, pass judgment under the pretext of your honor and the salvation of souls. Wherefore I thank you, supreme and eternal good, that in the manifesting of your truth and the deceitfulness of the devil and our own passions, you have made me know my infirmity. Wherefore I beseech you, through grace and mercy, that from today henceforward I may never again wander from the path of your doctrine, given by your goodness to me and to whoever wishes to follow it, because without you nothing is done. To you, then, Eternal Father, do I have recourse and flee, and I do not beseech you for myself alone, Father, but for the whole world, and particularly for the mystical body of the Holy Church, that this truth given to me, miserable one, by you, eternal truth, may shine in your ministers. And also, I beseech you especially for all those whom you have given me, and whom you have made one thing with me, and whom I love with a particular love, because they will be my refreshment to the glory and praise of your name, when I see them running on this sweet and straight road, pure and dead to their own will and opinion, and without any passing of judgment on their neighbor, or causing him any scandal or murmuring. And I pray you, sweetest love, that not one of them may be taken from me by the hand of the infernal devil, so that at last they may arrive at you, their end, Eternal Father. Also, I make another petition to you for my two fathers, the supports whom you have placed on the earth to guard and instruct me, miserable infirm one, from the beginning of my conversion until now, that you unite them, and of two bodies make one soul, and that they attend to nothing else than to complete in themselves, and in the mysteries that you have placed in their hands, the glory and praise of your name, and the salvation of souls, and that I, an unworthy and miserable slave, and no daughter, may behave to them with due reverence and holy fear, for love of you, in a way that will be to your honor, and their peace and quiet, and to the edification of their neighbor. I now know for certain, Eternal Truth, that you will not despise the desire of the petitions that I have made to you, because I know, from seeing what it has pleased you to manifest, and still more from proof, that you are the acceptor of holy desires. Your unworthy servant, will strive, according as you give me grace, to observe your commandments and your doctrine. Now, O Eternal Father, I remember a word which you said to me in speaking of the ministers of the Holy Church, to the effect that you would speak to me more distinctly in some other place of the sins which they commit today. Wherefore, if it should please your goodness to tell me anything of this matter, I will gladly hear it, so as to have material for increasing my grief, compassion, and anxious desire for their salvation. For I remember that you said that, on account of the endurance and tears, the grief and sweat and prayers of your servants, you would reform the Holy Church, and comfort her with good and holy pastors. I ask you this, in order that these sentiments may increase in me. How God renders this soul attentive to prayer, replying to one of the above-mentioned petitions. Then the eternal God, turning the eye of his mercy upon this soul, not despising her desire, but granting her requests, proceeded to satisfy the last petition which she had made concerning his promise, saying, "O best beloved and dearest daughter, I will fulfill your desire in this request, in order that, on your side, you may not sin through ignorance or negligence, for a fault of yours would be more serious and worthy of graver reproof now than before, because you have learnt more of my truth. Wherefore, apply yourself attentively to pray for all rational creatures, for the mystical body of the Holy Church, and for those friends whom I have given you, whom you love with particular love. And be careful not to be negligent in giving them the benefit of your prayers, and the example of your life, and the teaching of your words, reproving vice and encouraging virtue according to your power. Concerning the supports which I have given you, of whom you spoke to me, know that you are, in truth, a means by which they may each receive according to their needs and fitness. And as I, your Creator, grant you the opportunity, for without me you can do nothing, I will fulfill your desires. But do not you fail, or they either, in your hope in me. My providence will never fail you, and every man, if he be humble, shall receive that which he is fit to receive, and every minister that which I have given him to administer, each in his own way, according to what he has received and will receive from my goodness." The Dialogue of St. Catherine of Siena, Part 23. Of the dignity of the priest, and of the sacrament of the body of Christ, and of worthy and unworthy communicants. Now I will reply to that which you ask me concerning the ministers of the Holy Church. And, in order that you may the better understand the truth, open the eye of your intellect, and look at their excellence and the dignity in which I have placed them. And, since one thing is better known by means of contrast with its contrary, I will show you the dignity of those who use virtuously the treasure I have placed in their hands. And in this way, you will the better see the misery of those who today are suckled at the breast of my spouse. Then this soul obediently contemplated the truth, in which she saw virtue resplendent in those who truly taste it. Then said the eternal God, "I will first, dearest daughter, speak to you of the dignity of priests, having placed them where they are through my goodness, over and above the general love which I have had to my creatures, creating you in my image and similitude, and recreating you all to the life of grace in the blood of my only begotten Son, whence you have arrived at such excellence through the union which I made of my deity with human nature, so that in this you have greater dignity and excellence than the angels. For I took your human nature, and not that of the angels. Wherefore, as I have said to you, I, God, have become man, and man has become God, by the union of my divine nature with your human nature. This greatness is given in general to all rational creatures. But among these, I have specially chosen my ministers for the sake of your salvation, so that through them the blood of the humble and immaculate Lamb, my only begotten Son, may be administered to you. To them have I given the sun to administer, giving them the light of science and the heat of divine love, united together in the color of the body and blood of my Son, whose body is a sun, because he is one thing with me, the true Son, in such a way that he cannot be separated or divided from me, as in the case of the natural Sun, the star, in which heat and light cannot be separated, so perfect is their union. For the Sun, never leaving its orbit, lights the whole world, and warms whoever wishes to be warmed by it, and is not defiled by any impurity on which it shines, for its light and heat and color are united. So, this word, my Son, with his most sweet blood, is one Sun, one star, all God and all man, because he is one thing with me and I with him. My power is not separated from his wisdom, nor the fiery heat of the Holy Spirit from me, the Father, or from him, the Son. For he is one thing with us, the Holy Spirit, proceeding from the Father and the Son, and we together forming one and the same Sun, the star. That is to say, I, the eternal God, am that Sun, the star, whence have proceeded the Son and the Holy Spirit. To the Holy Spirit is attributed fire, and to the Son, wisdom, by which wisdom my ministers receive the light of grace, so that they may administer this light to others, with gratitude for the benefits received from me, the Eternal Father, following the doctrine of the Eternal Wisdom, my only begotten Son. This is that light which has the color of your humanity, color and light being closely united. Thus was the light of my divinity united to the color of your humanity, which color shone brightly when it became perfect through its union with the divine nature. And by this means of the incarnate Word mixed with the light of my divine nature and the fiery heat of the Holy Spirit, have you received the light. Whom have I entrusted with its administration? My ministers in the mystical body of the Holy Church, so that you may have life, receiving his body in food and his blood in drink. I have said to you that this body is, as it were, a sun, star. Wherefore you cannot receive the body without the blood, or the blood or the body without the soul of the incarnate Word, nor the soul nor the body without the divinity of me, the eternal God, because none of these can be separated from each other. As I said to you in another place, that the divine nature never left the human nature, either by death or from any other cause. So that you receive the whole divine essence in that most sweet sacrament, concealed under the whiteness of the bread. For as the Son cannot be divided into light, heat, and color, the whole of God and the whole of man cannot be separated under the white mantle of the host. For even if the host should be divided into a million particles, if it were possible, in each particle should I be present, whole God and whole man. When you break a mirror, the reflection to be seen in it is not broken. Similarly, when the host is divided, God and man are not divided, but remain in each particle. Nor is the sacrament diminished in itself, except as far as may be in the following example. If you have a light, and the whole world should come to you in order to take light from it, the light itself does not diminish, and yet each person has it all. It is true that everyone participates more or less in this light according to the substance into which each one receives the fire. I will develop this metaphor further that you may the better understand me. Suppose that there are many who bring their candles, one weighing an ounce, others 2 or 6 ounces, or a pound, or even more, and light them in the flame. In each candle, whether large or small, is the whole light. That is to say, the heat, the color, and the flame. Nevertheless, you would judge that he whose candle weighs an ounce has less of the light than he whose candle weighs a pound. Now, the same thing happens to those who receive this sacrament. Each one carries his own candle, that is, the holy desire with which he receives this sacrament, which of itself is without light, and lights it by receiving this sacrament. I say, without light, because of yourselves you can do nothing, though I have given you the material with which you can receive this light and feed it. The material is love, for through love I created you, and without love you cannot live. Your being, given to you through love, has received the right disposition in holy baptism, which you receive in virtue of the blood of the Word, for in no other way could you participate in this light. You would be like a candle with no wick inside it, which cannot burn or receive light, if you have not received in your soul the wick which catches this divine flame, that is to say, the holy faith, which you receive by grace in baptism, united with the disposition of your soul created by me, so fitted for love, that without love, which is her very food, she cannot live. Where does the soul united in this way obtain light? At the fire of my divine love, loving and fearing me, and following the doctrine of my truth. It is true that the soul becomes more or less lighted according to the material which it brings to the fire. For although you all have one and the same material, in that you are all created to my image and similitude, and being Christians, possess the light of holy baptism, each of you may grow in love and virtue by the help of my grace, as may please you. Not that you change the form of what I have given you, but that you increase your strength in love and your free will by using it while you have time. For when time is past, you can no longer do so. So that you can increase in love, as has been said, coming with love to receive this sweet and glorious light, which I have given you as food for your service through my ministers. And you receive this light according to the love and fiery desire with which you approach it. The light itself you receive entire, as I have said, in the example of those who, in spite of the difference in weight of their candles, all receive the entire light. And not divided, because it cannot be divided, as has been said, either on account of any imperfection of yours who receive, or of the minister. But you personally participate in this light, that is, in the grace which you receive in this sacrament, according to the holy desire with which you dispose yourselves to receive it. He who should go to this sweet sacrament in the guilt of mortal sin will receive no grace therefrom, though he actually receive the whole of God and the whole of man. Do you know the condition of the soul who receives unworthily? She is like a candle on which water has fallen, which can do nothing but crackle when brought near the flame, for no sooner has the fire touched it than it is extinguished, and nothing remains but smoke. So this soul has cast the water of guilt within her mind upon the candle which she received in holy baptism, which has drenched the wick of the grace of baptism, and not having heated it at the fire of true contrition and confession, goes to the table of the altar to receive this light with her body and not with her mind. Wherefore the light, since the soul is not disposed as she should be for so great a mystery, does not remain by grace in that soul, but leaves her and in the soul remains only greater confusion, for her light is extinguished and her sin increased by her darkness. Of the sacrament she feels nothing but the crackling of a remorseful conscience. Not through defect of the light itself, for that can receive no hurt, but on account of the water that was in the soul, which impeded her proper disposition, so that she could not receive the light. See, therefore, that in no way can this light, united with its heat and its color, be divided, either by the scanty desire of the soul when she receives the sacrament, or by any defect which may be in the soul, or by any defect of him who administers it, as I told you of the sun, which is not defiled by shining on anything foul, so the sweet light of this sacrament cannot be defiled, divided, or diminished in any way, nor can it be detached from its orbit. If all the world should receive in communion the light and heat of this sun, the Word, my only begotten Son, would not be separated from me, the true Son, his eternal Father, because in his mystical body, the Holy Church, he is administered to whoever will receive him. He remains holy with me, and yet you have him, whole God and whole man, as I told you in the metaphor of the light, that if all the world came to take light from it, each would have it entire, and yet it would remain whole.